Good morning. Welcome to Country Club United Methodist Church. My name is Richard Bell. Please stand as you are able for this morning's call to worship. We are here to praise God who has done wonderful things among us.
We are here because in Christ we are forgiven and made whole.
We are gathered because Jesus Christ has united us into one family of faith.
We will witness the good news. Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, frees and unites. Praise God. Hallelujah. Amen.
Please remain standing. Please join me in the opening prayer. O God, our Maker, whose eye regards even the sparrow, you care for this world you have made with tenderness. Through your living Spirit, you seek to redeem your lost creation and to make it whole again. So it was you sent your Son as servant, Lamb of God, to bind up our brokenness and heal our wounded spirits. Grant that we might be receptive to Christ's healing touch, that we may be made whole and set free to love. Amen.
You may be seated. As we continue in an attitude of prayer, I would invite you into a time of silence. And in that silence, you can silently lift up your prayers to God, whatever they may be, maybe a prayer for the chiefs today, or any prayers for healing, any prayers that you might have for new life. And then I will join us all together in prayer, and we'll conclude with the Lord's Prayer. Will you join me in silence? We thank you, O God, that somehow in the midst of the confusion and disintegration of life, you have spoken through your people in the world. You spoke in days of old through Abraham, Sarah, Moses, Samuel, and Jonah. You spoke through Jesus and Paul and the early saints of the church. And we know that you speak today to those who are willing to listen and share. This week we remember the life of one such person with whom you spoke and led in a special way. We remember Martin Luther King Jr. And as we do, we remember how you often speak through those whom humankind has rejected. How profound and reassuring about the human spirit that those who are so markedly persecuted become the lovers of life, the peacemakers, and the instruments by which you establish human community and justice. Help us to learn, O Lord, from Martin King, who was a man who had every reason to hate, and yet he preached, by way of his actions, an unending goodwill toward all people, even his enemies. As he did this, he revealed that his ultimate loyalty was with Jesus Christ, who taught us the way of love and peace. Help us, O Lord, not to live simply with the memory of Martin Luther King, but to embody that memory in such a way that we may have the courage to stand up for what is right and just and fair. And help us not to remember Martin Luther King just one day a year, but may every day be a day when we remember those who have inspired us and strengthened us to follow the life as a disciple of Jesus. Perhaps the greatest tribute that we could give this man of God is continue what he so well began to further the life of justice and peace. Grant us wisdom and courage to live up to the task. And so we ask that you hear all of our prayers today, those unspoken and those spoken, as we offer them through Jesus Christ, who also taught us to pray by saying, Our Father in heaven, holy is your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. I invite children that are here to come forward as we have a message especially for them. Come on down. Good morning. All right. Got your chief shirt on. Fantastic. I've asked Carol to help us out a little bit this morning. So thank you, Carol.
Hey. I am happy to tell you what I'm thinking about the Lamb of God. But I first would like to know what are words you would use to describe a lamb? Pop up there with what? Annoying? Oh, he says, bah, bah. You never know what you're going to get here. How about you guys? Anything at all? If you had a little lamb here with you and you could touch it, what would it feel like? Huh? You'd feel the wool? And is that wool hard as rocks? Is the lamb... Oh, what a lovely poetic thought. Hold that. You ought to write that in an essay. Feel a little bit like you were touching a cloud. I like that. Hey, Henry. I saw you walk into the church many times with a little pet. You would bring, was it a doggy you brought or a lammy or what was it? You don't remember now, but you have a lot of toys, don't you? Does anybody have one they sleep with? Hmm? It was a bunny. Oh, I do remember bunny, yes. Yeah, and they get raggedy and fall apart, don't they? I remember restuffing a toy that was beloved. Well, you know Delaney out here. Her mama, my daughter, had a favorite toy. She couldn't sleep without it. It was called Lammy. Lammy was just this cute little thing. It just fit under her arm. It was soft. It was cuddly, and it made her feel like she was taken care of, like she was okay, that everything was safe. Do you have things that make you feel safe and loved? All your stuffed animals. Of course. Those are things that we can touch and feel and love, right? Well, I want to tell you something. I want to ask you something. Have you ever been scared? Lots of times. Yeah. That's the perfect segue into what I'm going to tell you. When I was a little girl, in third grade, I was given a Bible. Had my name in it, and to me, I just knew that the Bible was something that if I held it close, it would give me comfort, because that was what a third grader thought. And so I was scared that when I got into bed, there was something underneath the bed. Uh-uh. And I would run and jump from a very wide distance out, land in bed with my Bible and hold it close. That was what I believed then. And in a way, it is what I believe now. Because the Lamb of God is Jesus, isn't it? Isn't that it? Okay, you're going to learn all about those things, my dear, and I'm so proud you're here with your Chiefs shirt on. Go Chiefs. You do? Well, do you know, we had a prayer this morning that says, God's eye is on the sparrow. God cares about the smallest of birds, animals, even bugs. He created these, God created things. And what you believe and what you think really matters. So I would like for you to hold Jesus very close. Henry, can you hold Jesus close in your heart? I think you might when you grow up because you have the most lovely family and grandparents I know. And so do you and you. You just have the best families, don't you? I do believe that God is with us here today, and Jesus Christ is the Lamb of God that we can feel close to. Should we bow our heads for just a moment? Dear God, thank you for giving us your Son, your beautiful Lord Jesus, whom we worship and adore. May we be more like him every day. Amen.
Please stand for the reading of the scripture. The next day he saw Jesus coming toward him and declared, "Here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, 'After me comes a man who ranks ahead of me because he was before me.' I myself did not know him, but I came baptizing with water, and for this reason, that he might be revealed to Israel." And John testified, "I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it remained on him. I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water said to me, 'He on whom you see the Spirit descend and remain is the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit.' And I myself have seen and have testified that this is the Son of God." The word of God for the people of God.
You may be seated. As we think about this scripture and this idea of the Lamb of God, if you would like to turn a page in your program, you'll find a sermon outline, and you're welcome to use that to follow along. Will you pray with me? Dear Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts and minds be acceptable in your presence, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. One of the most exciting times of my life was when I earned my driver's license. And even though the process of learning to drive was a trying time for my parents, I know they too were relieved when I finally received my license. Because from that time on, they no longer had to drive me and my younger brother and sister all over town to Boy Scouts, baseball, tennis matches, and dancing lessons. They could just hand me the keys, and I became the chauffeur for the day. I thought it was a wonderful arrangement, and my parents were pleased to see that I was gaining some independence. The only real problem was that I sometimes forgot to fill the gas tank back up after I used the car. I remember one particular morning following a day when I had picked up my sister from her dancing lesson, taken my brother to two different baseball games, and played tennis at a court on the other side of town. And on that morning, my father got into the car to drive me to school. As we rolled out of the driveway and into the street, the car sputtered and died right in the middle of the road. My father looked at the dashboard and realized that we were out of gas. "I just put gas in this car 2 days ago," he muttered. Then he looked over at me. There I was, guilty as ever of driving the car down to its last fumes and not filling it back up. I thought of all kinds of explanations, like telling him that someone must have come in the middle of the night and siphoned all the gas out of the tank. But nothing seemed appropriate. There are some times in life when words are just out of order, and that was one of them. My dad just sat there and looked at me. His caring eyes were filled with a double message. Genuine concern for me becoming a responsible adult, and obvious anger over my deed. I thought he would certainly revoke my driving privileges, and I was ready to accept my punishment. After what seemed like an eternity to me, my father broke the silence. Looking me straight in the eye, he said, "I wish you wouldn't drive the car until it is nearly out of gas. Now let's get out and push the car over to the side of the road. Then you can go to the gas station and get a can of gas." That was it. No other pronouncements, no other punishment. There in the front seat of the car, face to face with my father, eyeball to eyeball with an understanding but unrelenting parent, I felt both condemned and vindicated, both guilty and forgiven. It seemed that my dad was looking at me with two faces, one stern with judgment and the other filled with forgiveness. I guess love always offers us a healthy mixture of both. In many ways, that is the message of our gospel lesson from John this morning. The passage talks about the double impact of the light of holy love coming into our lives, suggesting that we believe in a two-faced God, one who confronts us with our sins and one who saves us with the forgiveness of heaven. God has two faces, one which cuts us down to size and the other which lifts us up to glory. Let me explain. The first face of God is judgment. Simply put, there is judgment in God's love. In our passage, John the Baptist looks at Jesus and sees the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. These words have brought hope and help to millions of believers across the centuries. They remind us that in Jesus, the reach of God's love goes forth into all the world. Few people realize, however, that the Lamb of God brings as much judgment as it offers hope. The main thing that John says is that this Lamb deals with the sin of the world, a world in bondage to sin. When light is revealed, our sins are uncovered. To be saved, we must be rescued, liberated from something. That something is our sins, our destructive behavior. God's love always confronts the world and those of us who live in it when life is less than it was fashioned to be at creation. Despite all the wonderful things that happen to our hearts when Jesus becomes our Savior, our first genuine encounter with Him is one of judgment, where each of us, in our own way, becomes keenly aware of just how far we have fallen short of heaven's expectation of our lives. In a sermon many years ago, Dr. Brown Barr referred to Jesus as the third thief on Golgotha. Unlike the first two thieves who had stolen material objects from individuals, Jesus was a different kind of thief, Barr explained. He robbed the arrogant man of his self-sufficiency. He robbed the snobbish woman of her self-centeredness. He robbed contented people of their self-imposed tranquility and made them come clean with their greatest faults and their deepest needs. And it was only then, after judgment had been levied, that salvation took place. To say it another way, Jesus disturbed the peace long before he dispersed the peace. Why? Because there is judgment in God's love. For the Lamb of God came to take away the sins of the world. And for the Lamb of God to take away those sins, we must first acknowledge our sins. Judgment is the first face of God. But there is another face to consider, one which offers hope of starting over again. The second face of God is forgiveness. That means there is love in God's judgment. The Lamb of God came to take away the sins of the world. Had Jesus preached only judgment, his would have been a destructive doctrine, and we would have been little more than disciples of disaster. Judgment is never the end of God's love. It's the first step toward redemption of the world as a whole and each of our lives in specific. Jesus, the Lamb of God, came not to judge us into misery, but rather to forgive us into heaven. No sooner do we feel the guilt of failing to live up to God's expectations than we feel the gift of God's unfailing grace that forgives us as we are and frees us to be new creatures in Christ Jesus. While there are many people in the world who try to overlook the judgment behind God's love, I suspect there are even more souls who cannot see the love behind God's judgment. They feel so guilty or worthless or insignificant that they just cannot believe God's love can make a difference in their lives. Their memory of that tragic mistake which they made in the past, or that terrible injustice that was done against them so long ago, has blinded them to the possibility of anything new or better in the present. There are all kinds of people everywhere whose hearts are crammed with every type of emotional and psychological or spiritual pain. These women and men are looking for something that will lift their burden. Some even show up at church hoping that Christ's never-dying love will take away their sin and lift their burden, though deep inside they do not think anything life-changing is likely to take place. There's a parable told by Hasidic rabbis that tells of an old man making his way alongside the road. Over his shoulder, he carried a huge bag filled with so many items that he could barely stand up, let alone walk. A second man came along in an ox-driven cart, and being moved with compassion at his brother's plight, offered to give the first a ride. The first man threw his bag over the side rail and jumped into the back of the cart. A good way down the road, the driver looked back to check on his passenger and was shocked by what he saw. The old man was standing up in the cart with his heavy sack still hanging over his shoulder. There are many people in the world today who are in that very same predicament. They're still trying to carry the weight of their worries on their own. They long for God's powerful love to give them a new hope in life. But for some reason, they just will not turn loose of their burden and give God the chance to hold them up. They hear John call Jesus the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. But they just cannot make themselves believe that such compassion and forgiveness and redemption was meant for them. But what we proclaim today is that there is love in God's judgment. And when it penetrates your heart, it also changes your life. What we proclaim today is that that love and forgiveness and redemption is available to all. To me, to you, to everyone. To relieve us of the burdens and sins that we may carry with us. For many of us, the Lamb of God is probably not an image that we use too often when we talk about Jesus. Throughout Scripture, lambs are associated with gentleness, with innocence, and dependence. God is the shepherd who gathers the lambs in because they are helpless. In the prophet Nathan's parable of King David's great sin, the lamb stands for helpless innocence. In God's coming kingdom, the lamb will feed and lie down with the wolf. The prophet Jeremiah, in reaching for an image of complete helplessness and innocence, speaks of the lamb that is led to the slaughter. In speaking of the vulnerability of his disciples, Jesus says that he sends them out as lambs in the midst of wolves. In comparison with these passages, for John to say that Jesus is the Lamb of God is to speak of the surprisingly gentle way that God deals with our sin. Our sin deserves fierce rebuke, judgment, condemnation, and punishment. And yet, in the face of our horrible sin, we get an innocent lamb. We expected God to come in the world as a warrior, as the Messiah who would execute fierce and terrible judgment, well-deserved judgment of our sin. And what we got was a lamb. Most numerous of all the images of the lamb in Scripture are passages that relate to the lamb with sacrifice. Lambs are especially related to that lamb of sacrifice. Lambs are specifically related in more than 80 passages in Exodus, Leviticus, and Numbers. Paul calls Jesus the Paschal Lamb, the gentle Lamb, and our terrible sin are linked together throughout Scripture. For the life of me, I cannot think of much that God has equipped lambs to do to defend themselves. They have no claws, no sharp teeth. They are far from the fastest moving of animals. When attacked, there is not much for a lamb to do but to receive the blows, to stand and take its fate. If John the Baptist had looked at Jesus that day by the river and said, "Behold, the Lion of God, who comes to track down the sinners in the world," it would have made good sense. in calling Jesus the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, John reveals something of the way God saves us in Jesus Christ. Living as we do in a world of sin, we must also consider what this passage means to us as followers of the Lamb. Followers of the Lamb must encounter the sin of the world as He encountered it, must wage war against evil with the weapons that He used: love, forgiveness, gentleness, while still pursuing justice. Today's gospel says something dramatic and revealing about Jesus, and yet it also has implications for those of us who would follow Jesus, those who would be followers of the Lamb. Over 15 years ago, in Durham, North Carolina, two college students were out on a date. There was drinking, too much drinking, certainly too much alcohol to be driving a car. As the boy was driving her home, there was a terrible accident. She was killed. Police charged the boy with manslaughter, and preparations were made for a trial. It seems to me certainly an appropriate response to such sin. The perils of driving under the influence of alcohol are well known. A young man in his early 20s should certainly know better. If we coddle and send drunk drivers off with just a pat on the head, we are asking for even more trouble and tragedy. Just before the trial, the parents of the young woman who had died met with the young man and issued a statement. They said, "One precious, wonderful life has already been lost. We do not want to lose another. This young man has served a few days in jail, and as far as we are concerned, that is enough. He has wronged us terribly. We want him to be sentenced to life, to go on and make something of himself, to live a life that our daughter will never be able to live. We therefore urge that he be allowed to live in the light of this tragedy, to go on and make something of himself for good." The state decided, after the parents' plea, not to prosecute the case further. Innocent, helpless, terribly wronged and wounded people, forgiving, taking away the burden, allowing someone to live. It reminds me of today's gospel. It reminds me of the Lamb of God. Will you pray with me? Gracious and loving God, we come to you knowing that we in our world is filled with sin, and that you have every right to judge us and to punish. But today we also realize that you came as a lamb to take away the sins of the world, to offer forgiveness and hope of new life. And so it is with that love that goes beyond judgment that we seek to live each day, following in your way, following the Lamb. In your name we pray. Amen. Thank you for being here with me this morning in this great worship time, and to share with me in this scripture and this time of song and all that we're doing. In just a moment, we're going to be receiving our offering, but before we do, I want to explain something in your program. There's a card that looks like this that's in there. If you'll take it out, on one side it says connection, and here's where we would like for you to write your name on there and any other information you could give us. We'd appreciate that. And then as the offering plate is passed, you can place that in the offering plate. We like to be keep record of everyone who's with us in worship. Then on the other side, it says commitment. And here's where we want you to think about what you're going to do as a result of being with us in worship this morning. There's two things there that we'd like for you to think about. One says, I will give thanks to God this week for taking away my sins. If you're willing to do that, if you'll check that box. And the second one is, as a follower of the Lamb, I will encounter the sin of the world as He encountered it with love and mercy. If you're willing to do that, if you'll check that box. Both of those commitments are also at the bottom of the outline in your program. So if you take that home with you, you can remember what it is that you're committing to. And then we'll place all of this in the offering plate as it's passed. Also, if you have any prayer requests, if you'll list them there, we have prayer teams that will pray over those. And then on the left-hand side of the card, if there's some information you'd like to know more about Country Club United Methodist Church, if you'll check that, we'll be sure to get back with you. Now, as we receive our offering, if you're visiting with us today, we don't expect you to give to the church. We're just glad that you're here. But if you do decide to give something, I want you to know that the money that is given supports the ministries of this church, both the ministries that we have within these walls and the ministries that we reach out into the world, into the neighborhood, into the world. And we're just grateful for all that you do and all that you are. Will the ushers please come forward? Will you join me in our prayer of dedication? O God, we recognize that we have been blessed with great abundance. In offering these gifts, may we be strengthened to proclaim your faithfulness and your salvation this day and always. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
Loving Zeal.
ask you to be seated for just a moment. You know, we have a special occasion today, and we want to remember that, and that is a great birthday of one of our own, Letty Bautista. We're so great to be able to celebrate. Many people are here to be here to celebrate with her. You know, I didn't know much about Letty before. Obviously, I didn't know anything about her before I came here, but I've learned so much in a short period of time. But I want to share with you just a little bit of, about her and her life. You know, she graduated from high school when she was 16 years old, and then attended Silliman University, founded by the Presbyterian Board of Foreign Missions in 1901, and was the first American university in Asia. She later attended the University of the Philippines, where she was awarded the Bachelor of Science degree in chemistry. I have a degree in chemistry, too, so we have a real bond there. She graduated in 1951. My degree came a little bit later. While she was waiting for Procter & Gamble to open a facility in Manila, she was talked into substituting for a physics teacher on maternity leave. She loved teaching so much that she never left the classroom and remained a high school teacher until her retirement in 1999. She and Obi and their three children came to the United States in September of 1962, and both obtained their master's degree in 1964 from the University of Oklahoma. Another connection that we have. I'm from Oklahoma, grew up in Tulsa. She then started teaching physics at Westport High School, where she was voted the most popular teacher three times in a contest sponsored by the WDAF. The family attended worship here at Country Club United Methodist Church, their first Sunday in town, because they knew how to get to 57th and Warnell. It was their plan to visit Central United Methodist Church and Westport and different places, but the Crusaders class, and notably Phyllis and Bucky Walters, made them feel so welcomed that they stayed here. To this day, Letty has not attended a Sunday worship service anywhere else in Kansas City. She taught 2 years at Sunset Hill, and then the family returned to Norman, Oklahoma for further graduate work at the university. Letty taught full-time at the University Lab School while doing coursework in the evenings. Richard Bell was one of her students. Is that right? How about that? All right. In 1971, she started teaching physics and chemistry at Shawnee Mission West High School, returning to the University of Oklahoma in the summer to finish her research, and she finally got her PhD in 1974. Letty loved to travel and for several years took three students to New York during their spring break. She drove for 2 days each way to get there. Then in 1978, she rented a car with three students, toured Europe for 3 weeks. Quite an achievement for someone who had only learned to drive when she was 37. Obi stayed home and taught summer school at Central Missouri State University. She and Obi traveled abroad twice a year after her retirement, five times with family and friends, most memorably with a 10-day trek to the base camp of the Himalayas when she was 69 years old and Obi was 71. She was very active in the Curcio movement, having worked 16 weekends, and served as rector of HOAC5 in Liberty, Missouri, and an Emmaus weekend in Junction City, Kansas. She's held several positions here at Country Club United Methodist Church, chairman of the administrative board. She also planned programs for the Crusaders from the 80s through 2010, and has done most of the fellowship dinners and memorial service receptions. Her visits to the sick and shut-ins keep her busy and fulfilled. That's probably one of the things that I know most about Letty. In my first week here, Letty contacted me and said that she wanted to take me personally and introduce me to all the shut-ins and those who couldn't make it to church on Sunday. I said, well, okay. Later I learned you never say no to Letty. She took me around and introduced me personally to those who are in nursing homes and shut-ins here at Country Club Church. And I'll never forget that. They received her as a part of their family. She was always well loved. And it was really very important that she be the one to introduce me. It gave them a sense that I too could be a part of their family. She also does volunteer work at Turning Point, a center for hope and healing at the St. Joseph's Hospital. There's so much that we can say about Letty, and many of you could probably say things as well. And Sydney Ann has something that she would like to share also, and so I'm going to ask her to come forward at this time, and she'll step up to the lectern. But I know in a few moments we're going to have a little reception, and everyone's going to be invited to come down to the library straight down this hall here on my left, your right. And you'll get a chance to share with her as well some of your experiences. But Letty Ann, go ahead.
Well, we certainly are honoring a very special lady this morning, and we're honored that so many of her family are here today. And all of you are invited for a reception following with refreshments and a light lunch. The thing I wanted to say about Letty is the fact that she has such a inquisitive mind, and she is always up for a new adventure. I couldn't help but think of this story that really did happen. I hope I have the right prints. When he mentioned about their going to the Himalayas, the story afterwards was this, that she wanted to make this trek in up the mountain and do a hike that Prince Charles had done. And that does show you her adventuresome spirit. But they were in a very steep part of it, and supposedly Obi, her quiet and wonderfully supportive husband, leaned over and said, "Why are we doing this?" So that just, she has been another minister in a way to this church. And she has served in so many capacities and given so freely of herself. And we're grateful that to the Walters for seeing that she stayed at Country Club United Methodist Church. Thank you so much. Hope to see you at the reception.
Thanks, Sydney Ann. Before we give the benediction, I think it would be appropriate that we sing Happy Birthday to Letty. Let's have a little... That was a liturgical happy birthday with the organ. Wasn't that great? I'm going to invite you to stand for the benediction. And then immediately following the benediction, we'll do a little sung response. And after we do that sung response, I would invite Letty and the family to go first, to go down the hall to the library so that we'll get a chance to visit with them there. And then everyone is invited to come, get you a little snack. It'll hold you over until the football game. All right. All right, let's hear these words of the benediction. May God's love and forgiveness be upon you this day. May we recognize in Jesus the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. And may we enter now into the new life that God offers to us. Amen.
Walk in the light. Yes.